We've managed a break. As some of you will have seen, we took up camping in the garden, which is to be highly recommended because you can still use the dishwasher, the shower, the cooker, and the TV. So it's a great way of camping, and I thoroughly recommend it. As I said, today is Pentecost Sunday. It's also our Mission Sunday, and we've got the opportunity today to hear from a number of our mission partners. So thank you to Mervyn and to the Mission Committee, who are leading bits of the service today. We've got lots of different people contributing to the service today. So I hope the technology is going to work. There'll be a short pause between each item. Sandra Jones, one of our readers, will be preaching a little later on our theme of Pentecost. Let me begin, though, by reading a few verses from the Apostle Paul's letter to the Romans, picking up a verse from that first Pentecost Sunday from the Old Testament prophet Joel. We read this in Romans. For there is no difference between Jew and Gentile. The same Lord is Lord of all and richly blesses all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. How then can they call on the one they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one of whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them? And how can anyone preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gift of your Holy Spirit that we especially celebrate and give thanks for today. We thank you for giving the Spirit to all believers. And we thank you, Holy Spirit, for the gifts you shower upon your church. And today, as we also celebrate our Mission Sunday, we thank you for the calling and equipping you have given to each of our mission partners. Thank you for the call that you gave to your people over the centuries. Thank you for the call you gave to Joshua back in the Old Testament that we still hold to today. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. So come, Holy Spirit, fill us, equip us, rebuke us, inspire us, and unite us in Christ. Be among us here today, we pray, for your glory's sake. Amen. We're going to sing our first hymn, Build Your Kingdom Here.
Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil why we're made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come invade us now. Church, we need your power in us. We seek your kingdom first, we hunger and we thirst, refuse to waste our lives, for you're our joy and prize. To see the captive hearts released, the hurt, the sick, the poor, lay down our life for heaven's cause. We are your church. We pray, revive this earth. Build your kingdom here. Let the darkness fear. Show your clear. Show your mighty hand, heal our streets and land. Set your church on fire, win this nation back. Change the atmosphere, build your kingdom here, we pray.
Can you take your shirt off?
Well, hey!
He's got a t-shirt on, does he? He's just like got to be able to get to the back of it. Right, Harvey, let's do this and you'll be like a, I'll be like a real hairdresser. This is very
exciting. Should we pray? Shall we pray?
I think you need to pray.
Come on then, pray.
Put your hands together. Pray.
Pray.
Amen.
This is a very exciting day in the Clark household. And the reason it's an exciting day in the Clark household is because Harvey's clippers have arrived. As you can see, his hair is much too long. But the very exciting thing is I've never done this before. So Harvey's really scared and I'm really finding it hilarious. Anyway, back to the job in hand. Yes, so I wanted to get clipping his hair straight away, but then I realized that you had to have some power to do it. So we had to wait all night while we charged up the clippers. And I've become even more nervously hysterical in the meantime. And Harvey has become even more nervously nervous. So we're going to start now, and hopefully it will work.
Harvey, how do you feel?
I have the power.
I don't think she knows what you...
Okay, Harvey, put your head forward.
I don't think you know what you're doing. I do not hold you responsible.
Who do you hold responsible?
You.
I didn't do it. You can't hold me responsible.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah, but it's going to be short. You knew that.
Oh my goodness.
Who do you look like?
Like someone come out of prison.
Today we are celebrating Pentecost, the day on which the Holy Spirit was poured out on all believers. This is also Mission Sunday, the day when we think about, pray for, and learn more about our mission partners. The Holy Spirit and mission go hand in hand. Without the Holy Spirit, we do not have the power to go out and share the gospel. By now, I expect you're all asking yourselves what Pentecost and the Holy Spirit have to do with Harvey having his hair cut. And I do admit that the link is a little tenuous, but I thought we could all do with some laughter. Just as Harvey had to wait all night while his clippers were receiving the power needed to cut his hair, so the disciples were told by Jesus to wait for the Holy Spirit. Just as the clippers were unable to do the job they were created for until they had power, so we need the power of the Holy Spirit to do what God intends us to do. It was after receiving the Holy Spirit at Pentecost that Peter preached and about 3,000 people came to faith on one day. It was after they received the Holy Spirit that the disciples lost their fear and were able to speak freely about their faith in Jesus. Today, we do not have to wait for the Holy Spirit. In Ephesians, we are told that the Holy Spirit is given to us as a deposit to seal our faith the moment we first believe in Jesus. With the power of the Holy Spirit, our missionaries are able to go out to all the ends of the earth to spread the good news of Jesus. We too have the power of the Holy Spirit to love and serve others and to spread the good news of Jesus wherever we are and wherever we go. The last instruction that Jesus left with his disciples is in Matthew 28, verse 19, where he says, "Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit." We are now going to go to a children's song called Go, which is actually based on Matthew 28, verse 19.
Baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. All right, get ready.
Brilliant. Thank you very much, Susie. Thank you very much, Harvey. That's lovely. Just a couple of items of church family news. We have Start the Week prayers tomorrow morning, as usual, at 9:15. Liz Willis will be leading that. Looking forward to seeing people at those. There are a particular highlight, actually, of the frustration of lockdown is that actually more of us are being able to pray together for our central prayer meetings. So do join us if you'd like to tomorrow for 9:15 start the week prayers. And next Sunday, we have another first. As I think you've heard over the last couple of weeks in our notices, we have a church quiz in place of our evening service next Sunday at 5:30. An opportunity for us just to spend some time together, having a bit of fun. And we think that a quiz might be a great way for us to do that. You don't have to join a team, as in you'll be put in a team if there's just one, two, three of you. Teams of five, if you contact Andy Dunningham, and there are various links around. If you haven't got Andy's number, give me a call or give me an email and I'll pass your details on to Andy Dunningham. We're looking forward to that. But now I'm going to hand over to Mervyn, who's going to introduce some of our Mission Sunday information. Mervyn.
Okay, thanks. As Andy said, this is the day we have a special focus on the missions that we support as a church. And this year we're going to have interviews with two of our mission partners. Also, each day of this coming week, we'll be focusing on one of our other partners in the Thought for the Day. So we'll have a sort of missions week for once. So, should be the title page there at the moment. The people we support rely on us for more than financial support. And that's why each of our growth groups prays for at least one of these mission partners on a regular basis. They really do need our continuing prayers. They're often working in thankless and difficult situations, both here in this town and country or abroad. So just to remind you briefly who we support. So first of all, our local missions, Open Door for homeless men and women. And at the moment, they're very much involved with the Canonsgrove project, looking after homeless men and women from all over the district council area with other organizations as well. And then the Beesom, which works to help people in deprived situations. At the moment, they're quite involved with the food bank, and a further update will appear during the coming week. Taunton Team Chaplaincy, which involves Christians volunteering in shops and offices and on the streets. Remember shops and offices? It's interesting that on their website, TTC has the following words below the logo: the church that has left the building. Well, we've all done that right now. We're all doing it right now. And then Taunton Youth for Christ, doing just what the name says and working with young people across the town and in schools. And there are some really very exciting things happening through them at the moment. And a short video will be available on Thursday in Worship from Home. We also support Jenny Green, who works in a challenging area of Bradford. And a short video from Jenny will be shared this coming Friday. And the Bible Society, which works to translate and provide Bibles to Christians right across the world. So we also support Charles and Francis de Roma, and we are their sending church, so they're especially important to us. And in a few minutes, Charles and Francis themselves will be here with us to tell us more. And also Heidi and Bosco, who've planted a church in Uganda. Again, more from them in the coming week. New Life Foundation India was started in 2005 by our own Kay Whiteley, and shelters orphans and educates children who otherwise wouldn't have this opportunity. Kay has written an update which will be shared in this week's Mission Week. And the Belgrade Bible School in Serbia, which relies on our donations to train Bible teachers to work in many different areas of life across the Balkans. Andy Mayo was involved right from the start of the Bible School in 2006. And later in the service, I'll be showing an interview with Andy that I recorded earlier in the week. Details of our missions can be found on the Troll Church website under the Grow heading. And we've deliberately not done a pledge leaflet this time. Well, how would we get it out to you? Supporting our missions. Now, how can we actually support? How can I help, you ask? Well, I hope you ask. Certainly by praying, but also by joining us in financially supporting our missions fund. If you already contribute, then thank you. And please think about increasing your donation. Both large and small contributions and increases are valuable. And of course, all these mission partners are affected by the present world crisis. So please do pray especially for each of them as they adjust what they're doing. Thank you very much for supporting our mission partners. And I now hand over to Peter Chu for an interview with Charles and Francis.
Hey. Hello, Peter.
Thank you for joining us this morning. Judging by what I can see of your curtains, you've got bright sunshine there as well.
Pretty much,
at times.
Yeah, at times. Okay, first of all, could you just give us a resume of your situation there in Belgium to date, and so a little bit of your past history? Okay, thank you.
So we came out to Belgium, now it's over 27 years ago, which is just amazing because we live each week saying, can we do this for another week? Keep going. So the fact that we're still here after 27 years is already a miracle. We started a church in the small town we live in about 15 years ago. And we have a small church with its ups and downs. People come, people go, numbers go up, numbers go down. But we have somewhere between 20 and 30 people attending services. And today we had about the same on Zoom. So that's where we are at the moment. We don't have team members working with us at the moment. So the tech team is us. The music team is us. The Sunday school team, we do have a small group of people helping us. But in general, it's us. So yeah, quite a heavy workload.
Okay, great. Can I just ask what the challenges have been of recent, and what you were hoping for after the lockdown starts to lift?
Yes, thank you, Peter. The running a church, as we're all discovering with WhatsApp and Zoom, rather like trial churches, is quite a challenge. It's exciting though. We actually felt we got there technically this morning with the service. We have a good WhatsApp group which shares lots of prayer information, lots of encouragement. But there are frustrations, as everyone feels. Trying to help people pastorally across the telephone isn't as easy, obviously, as it is face-to-face. Nevertheless, there are some advantages too. It's interesting to see that we've gained one or two people who wouldn't normally go to church. I'm sure it's the case of the trial as well. And Francis particularly has been writing to a neighbour here who's been asking for a Bible verse every day to meditate on, which is really quite good. Thank the Lord for that. Yeah.
So the deconfinement will happen, is started here, as it is with you. And we understand that later this week we'll be given some indication of what services we can hold in the future months. We're given to understand that singing might be a problem because of trouble with churches in Germany, as you probably heard as well. So if we do open up, will we have a church service without singing? Well, we meet in a small room usually, so will we be limited to six people? Who do we invite? We do have a garden at our home, and we could possibly fit more people in the garden. What happens if it rains? There's loads and loads of questions. So, we've no idea. Just like you probably have no idea what you'll be doing in a few weeks' time, we don't have any idea either.
No, I don't think we do have any clear idea. But anyway, I mean, you've already raised some issues that we can pray about there. Are there any other particular things you'd like us to pray about?
It's a very strategic, critical time for the church plant at the moment, because we're in the process of forming a church council through the changes we're going through. And church council formed from people, probably more from across Belgium, wise people that we're selecting, and to actually be the governing body of the church plant. And actually this week I'm looking forward to phoning up a few people and seeing whether they can be free to join us on that church council. That's a particular prayer request at the moment.
And for us, please pray for us that we will stay alive spiritually, that God will help us to stay firm in our faith and to grow us as individuals with him.
Can I actually take this opportunity of saying a big thank you? All Saints Trial and Angusley are our main supporting churches, both prayerfully and financially, and it really has been amazing what you have done over the years. So really, please keep it up. Yes.
Okay. Yeah, that's, we will. About contacting you and getting contact from you, could you just say something very briefly about your updates and how they can be received?
So there are two things, as you rightly say, updates, us giving you information, there's also the other side, which is you giving us your information, which is equally important. So please write to us, please ring us, please contact us. Just a little line to say you're praying for us is really encouraging to us. We really need your friendship and your support in that way, as well as you hearing what we're saying and praying for us. That aside, we have two systems of prayer letters, just to be not simple. One is every 3 months, there's a letter which gives you all the details of what's happened and what will be happening. And there are pictures for those of you who can't read. And then...
She's the artist.
And then once a month, we do a few prayer updates for those who like to pray. And in recent weeks, what we've done is to put a video on that, which lasts just 2 minutes. So if you're interested in reading something a bit more serious, ask for the monthly, for the 3 monthly prayer letters. If you want just to see us regularly, then ask for the monthly updates.
And it's all serious.
So, and our email address, I'm sure nearly everybody in Trail knows it. So contact Mervyn, Peter, David, anybody will know.
So. Yeah. Okay. Really. Thank you ever so much for that. It's been really great talking to you this morning.
Our pleasure.
Okay. Bye.
Okay. Thank you.
The collect for Pentecost. God, who has at this time taught the hearts of your faithful people by sending to them the light of your Holy Spirit, grant us by the same Spirit to have a right judgment in all things and evermore to rejoice in his holy comfort. Through the merits of Christ Jesus our Saviour, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Gracious God, give skill, sympathy, and resilience to all who are caring for the sick, and your wisdom to those searching for a cure. Strengthen them with your Spirit, that through their work many will be restored to health. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. On this Pentecost day, please join in prayer for our 10 mission partners. We will end each prayer section by saying, Lord, in your mercy. Please respond, hear our prayer. Lord God, please continue to give Charles and Francis and Banch strength and encouragement during these difficult times. Bring others to work alongside them to help build the church. Give Charles and Francis discernment as they begin the process with other churches of forming a new church council across Belgium.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Gracious God, please continue to give Jenny Green good health and the strength to keep serving you in a very deprived area of Bradford. As Jenny approaches retirement in August, give her the reassurance that the planned move to Carlisle will go smoothly.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. God, please protect the Bakira family in Uganda. Give Bosco and Heidi your wisdom and discernment during this pandemic, as they care for those in their church and the community, both spiritually and with practical help. Help Bosco and Heidi to continue sharing the gospel at a time when they are unable to meet as a church family. Give your strength and protection to the people of Uganda as they deal with not only the virus, but severe poverty and floods.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. We thank you, gracious God, for the life of Mina Hembron, who sadly died last week. Mina, with Kay Whiteley, was a co-founder of the New Life Foundation School in India. Thank you for Kay and others as they continue the ministry of New Life Foundation. Give them the strength and endurance to carry on with their work during these very difficult times. Funding is desperately needed. Please pray for all staff members and students for their spiritual and emotional well-being.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. God, we give thanks for the donations of food and money to Taunton Beesom and pray for the safety and protection of all volunteers.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. We thank you, gracious God, for the inspiring work of Taunton Youth for Christ, led by Aunt Stevens. May they continue to bring the gospel to schools in Taunton.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
God, we lift up the work of the Belgrade Bible School to you. Please continue to pray for Karolina, a former student who has been ministering in South Serbia for 20 years with special responsibility for worship and youth work.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
We also give you thanks, gracious God, for the other missions that we support, the Bible Society, Open Door, and Taunton Team Chaplaincy. We ask that you give all who work in mission the strength and endurance to do your work and spread your word, bringing the message of Christ's unconditional love and mercy to all.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Let us end with the prayer that the Lord taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
The next song will be O Church Arise. Have the price for which he died.
Strengthen every stride. Give grace for every hurdle that we may run with faith to win the prize of a servant good and faithful. And stands of bold still line the way, retelling triumphs of his grace. We hear the calls and hunger for the day when with Christ we stand in glory.
I want to introduce you to Andy Mayo. He's a great guy, great Christian, brilliant musician and composer. He leads Oak Hall Expeditions, which some of you may have travelled with his father and brother, and helps lead Oak Hall Church in Caterham. I feel privileged to call him a friend after knowing him for nearly 16 years. And here's an interview that I recorded with him earlier this week. Right. Hi, Andy. Really, really good to have you with us today. And I've got just one or two questions I'd like you to answer if you can. And I'll leave you a bit of fairly free to do that. So first of all, what is your involvement with the Belgrade Bible School, Andy?
Thanks, Mervyn. Well, can I just say how lovely it is to be with you here in Troll today. And we know that you as a church have been connected with us for such a long time. And so thank you. Well, in Belgrade, it's very exciting. There is a Bible school on the edge of the city, and it's been running now for a quarter of a century, if you can imagine, approaching quarter of a century. So back in the 90s, during the war, a number of people traveled out to what was then Yugoslavia, taking humanitarian aid, partnering with local Christians, and sharing this practical help, but also talking about Jesus. Probably very much like what some of you have been doing during these last weeks with friends and neighbours who are a little in need. And as we did that, a number of people said, well, actually, look, I want to know more about this. And some of those people came to know Jesus. And to cut a long story short, out of that war and that terror and that brokenness, well, this Bible school began. And there was a need for people to be involved in that team. And so there was a number of us involved at the beginning, a couple called Jan and Nada, who are from Serbia. But then also my wife, Faye, and I moved out there to be involved. We thought it'd be a project that would last just a year, but it built year on year, because those who studied, they studied through the whole Bible in a year. It was very practical, engaged in outreach in the refugee camps and on the radio stations and with children in some of the more needy parts of the area. And then these students then went out to be involved in planting churches and carrying on new projects like these. But then they sent their new people back to study. And so this project just snowballed. And instead of being there for a year or two, after 8-9 years, we were still there. But actually, over that time, we'd been slowly building a team around us. We'd moved from very kind of temporary situation in the north to this big hotel that we'd been able to buy on the edge of Belgrade. And the Bible school then, in its 11th year, became just being led by a local team. And it's that team now that lead that Bible school on. And Faye and I have moved back here to the UK.
Okay, right. That's great. I first met Andy in 2004, which was really exciting. He was actually out there at the time working. I think it was the last time I saw him actually working out there as such. He actually led the Taste of Mission trips that I was privileged to be part of after that. But yeah, thanks, Andy. What's happened to the Bible school in this period, and what's the latest news from Serbia in this this terrible time, please?
Yes, well, Serbia has had a lockdown like we have. In some ways, it's been stricter than ours. But the people who follow Jesus have had a history of real serious difficulties. So there was the war. Then later in 1999, there was a NATO bombed Serbia. And at these different points, people were saying, look, actually, when there is a disaster like this, well, the church is just going to be finished. You know, there's no hope. But actually, what they realize is that at those moments, God was working most powerfully. And those who were relying on him more more strongly than ever, knowing they needed his help more than ever, found that God was working powerfully at those times. And so at this moment, they've been doing all sorts of practical things like bringing food parcels to people, helping with masks, even making things like that. But in everything, people have been looking on from the culture, looking in and saying, look, you seem to have a hope that others of us don't have. And there's been a great set of opportunities. For the Bible school itself, the center, that we'd actually planned this year not to have a group of students, and because there were some renovations needed on this big old hotel. And so those renovations have gone ahead and have continued to go ahead. And we wouldn't have been able to run the Bible school anyway during these months. There's a real sense of hope, a real sense of purpose, a sense that those who are following Jesus Christ have answers, not twee cheap answers, but they have the hope of a world that is broken, but a savior that was broken to bring redemption, and one that they are pointing towards, and they are encouraged even though it's a challenging time.
Thanks, Andy. I know this is an extra sort of question to what I'd actually put to you, but have you got an example of perhaps just one person or one couple recently in this time who might just have something to say to us?
Yes. Okay. Daniel. His name is Daniel and his wife is Alexandra. They live down on the Kosovan border. They're Romani people. They're kind of looked down on, excluded as a kind of minority people group. But Daniel and his wife Alexandra have been have targeted the 1,000 people in their ethnic group in their town who are at the bottom of the pile. They've gone to the local council, got a list of the most needy out of them all, have organized humanitarian aid, and have made packages and gone out to visit all these people following all the guidelines from the government. And at a point where everyone's kind of inward looking, trying to fix their own lives, this couple have been outward looking and trying to help others, and because of their faith in Jesus. And it's been a great story to be told in that town, and people will be talking about it for years afterwards, I'm sure. And the fruit of those kinds of actions will be seen for years afterwards too. So one example.
Great, thanks. It's just great how people are able to actually put their faith into practice. You know, the church has really got outside the doors in this situation, hasn't it?
Yeah.
Great. And so perhaps just to sort of round off, what can we take away from this time with you that we could actually pray for, please?
Yes. Well, I would begin by saying, well, I think together in Trull and wherever we're based, and we're worshipping a God who is sovereign and good and powerful, and his sovereignty is seen through these moments, I think. So I think we should be just praising him for the fact that he turns broken things into wonderful moments of his work among us. I think, too, we can be praying for our cultures, that men and women will be seeing how we're in need of a saviour, and we'll be calling out and searching and finding the Lord Jesus, praying for ourselves in Trull or in Belgrade or wherever it is that we're based, that we'd be his faithful witnesses with his power working through us to point to Jesus. You could pray for the Bible school, for the team as they prepare to launch this next year, for the right students to come to study. for the graduates who are right across the region now, about 360 of them serving in different places, like Daniel and Alexandra, and that they'd be seeing fruit and have their eyes fixed on Jesus too as they continue. So thank you for this partnership and this friendship, and thank you for your ambassador, Mervyn, who you've been sending out to support us there. And thank you for this moment to be together too. So greetings from us to you.
Okay, thanks, Andy. And take our greetings to your church as well, please, and to others you come into contact with. And amongst Andy's other amazing gifts is the fact that he's a fluent Serbian speaker. So if I just sort of say, Hvala puno, Andy.
Wow.
Thanks very much.
See you soon.
Bye. Bye. So I'm going to move on now to introduce Amanda. Amanda's going to do our reading, our Bible reading for us, please. Thank you.
The reading this morning is from the book of Acts, chapter 2, verses 1 to 12. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now they were staying in Jerusalem, God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment, because each one heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Aren't all these who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in our native language?" Parthians, Medes, and Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs, we hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues. Amazed and perplexed, they ask one another, "What does this mean?" This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
May the words of my mouth and the thoughts of all our hearts be now and always acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Well, as we all know, today is Pentecost, and many people would consider that to be the birthday of the church. So happy birthday, everyone. It's a major festival in the church's calendar. So one might be forgiven for wondering, well, where are all the happy Pentecost cards and the chocolate tongues of fire? Fortunately, unlike Christmas and Easter, which one commentator described as norm-busting stories that have been domesticated and toned down, this norm-busting story seems to have escaped any attempts at commercialization. Downside of that is that beyond the church itself, not a lot of people know what it's all about. They're probably familiar with the term Whitsun, or White Sunday, traditionally a time when baptisms took place. But of course, the colour of Pentecost is red, like fire. It's vibrant and it's powerful. And today we should really be on fire for Jesus, letting people know what Pentecost really means. That it isn't just a story about paranormal activity. Pentecost was originally a major Jewish festival, which ensured that there were a lot of pilgrims in Jerusalem from across the known world, just as there was at Passover. The word Pentecost means 50th, and it took place 50 days after Passover, and was a feast of harvest or feast of weeks, one of the three annual feasts that the Jewish people were commanded to celebrate, and they're recorded in both Exodus and Deuteronomy. Now, 50 days after Passover also happens to be 50 days after Jesus' resurrection and 10 days after his ascension. It's unlikely to be coincidence that such a powerful event as the outpouring of the Holy Spirit just happens to come about on this day, any more than the events surrounding Easter were a coincidence, taking place at Passover. This is about maximum impact, and perhaps we, being so far removed from it, can easily underestimate that impact and the power of this unconstrained Spirit of God. It tells us in Acts chapter 1 that the disciples have been waiting for this moment ever since the Ascension, and Jesus promised that they would receive power when the Holy Spirit came upon them, and that they would be his witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. Now, they obviously realised that this would take some doing, and in Acts 1:14, we're told they all came together in prayer. They also made use of this waiting time by appointing Matthias to replace Judas Iscariot, and this elite group then became known as apostles, a word which means messenger or missionary. But they still needed to be equipped for this job. They needed a revival of their energy and enthusiasm. And at this point, as another commentator said, they were like empty vessels waiting to be filled. So on Pentecost, they were all gathered together, as was their custom, still waiting for something to happen. And then it happened in no uncertain terms. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire. And I emphasize those words, like and seem, because it doesn't say that there was a wind, just a noise like a violent wind. It doesn't say there were actual tongues of fire, just something that seemed to be tongues of fire. But whatever it was, I don't think we can have any idea of the power that swept into that room. This noise was so loud that the people outside could hear. Or the people inside? Well, surely their hearts must have been pumping like mad as adrenaline surged through their bodies, and they were filled with this overwhelming sense of God's presence and power, and it just pours out of them in 16 different languages. The Bible tells us that the people outside were amazed. They were bewildered, perplexed. Or perhaps putting it in more modern terms, they were in an uproar, beside themselves, blown away, gobsmacked, but completely uncomprehending as this unconstrained Spirit of God did his work. But this was absolute perfect timing. People from all over the known world heard the message in their own language. We didn't read Peter's speech, which follows this passage, but it meant that he had an international audience, which resulted in a harvest of new believers throughout the known world. So a celebration of the harvest of the crops of the earth resulted in a new kind of harvest from the fields of the world, people being harvested for God. And this gives us a big clue as to what Pentecost is all about. It is all about mission. This is about God's people being empowered to witness to all of the nations. So that it says in Habakkuk 2, the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord, and the waters cover the sea. And whether we like it or not, each and every one of us has a responsibility to take on this task in one way or another, to use those God-given gifts that we so often speak about. Now, maybe someone here has had a dramatic encounter with the Spirit, but most of us may well be wondering, well, how do I know if the Spirit is working in me? I haven't had a wham-bam experience. I don't really feel a lot different. But the Spirit moves in many different ways. He's mentioned in the Bible from Genesis through to Revelation. And if you look up the Holy Spirit on the internet, you'll find well over 100 descriptions. The implied relationship is always of God. So what matters is your experience of God's presence in your life here and now, not whether you had a dramatic encounter. And Paul would tell us that the work of the Holy Spirit can be told by the fruit that is produced. So that if your life in Christ is bearing fruit, then yes, you have received the Spirit. You flip the switch. You've turned the power on. And of course, we do need to do that. We need to flip the switch and turn on the power, asking the Holy Spirit to empower us each day. Now, equally, we can reject the Spirit. We have that choice. And the Bible speaks of people who grieve the Spirit in Ephesians, of people who insult the Spirit in Hebrews, and people who put out the Spirit's fire in 1 Thessalonians. People who choose the ways of the world, who look after self-interest and self-fulfillment before giving a thought to what God might want. There's a lot of thought about spirituality today, in all of its various forms, about getting in touch with ourselves, finding ourselves. And yes, we do need to do that. And the Holy Spirit will certainly help us do that. But beyond that, we must let the Spirit keep working, pushing us beyond our expectations, beyond our comfort zones, if we are going to be part of this mission. The Holy Spirit, we must remember, is never limited by our lack of understanding or vision. At Pentecost, the Holy Spirit filled the apostles. But if you read the Acts, you will find that being filled is not just a one-off event. It can happen over and over again as someone is equipped for a specific ministry. Because the Holy Spirit just overcomes all barriers and can and will use anyone at any time. But who or what is this Holy Spirit that can so empower us? In John 4:24, Jesus says that God is Spirit. That's the same Spirit that he breathed on his disciples, the same Spirit that rested on him at Pentecost and filled those empty vessels. Other descriptions, and there are many, the active presence of God in the life of the church, power that enables the Christian to live an obedient, productive, and fruitful life, someone who wants to give us power so that we can tell others about Jesus. And of course, the Spirit is certainly all of those things. But perhaps a good description is that given by A.W. Tozer. And he said, the Holy Spirit is a person. He is not enthusiasm. He is not courage. He is not energy. He is not the personification of all good qualities, like Jack Frost is the personification of cold weather. The Holy Spirit is not the personification of anything. He is a person, the same as you are a person, but not material substance. He has individuality. He is one being and not another. He has will and intelligence. He has hearing. He has knowledge and sympathy and ability to love and see and think. He can hear, speak, desire, grieve, and rejoice. He is a person. He is God. And this Spirit, who is God, lives in you and lives in me. Well, now, if that doesn't blow us away, leave us beside ourselves and gobsmacked, then nothing will. If we cannot see the potential in that, then there isn't a lot of hope for us. Pentecost began a new era, the era of the Holy Spirit. This is the fulfillment of prophecy, as in Joel 2:28, I will pour out my Spirit on all people, and the fulfillment of Jesus' promise, empowering his disciples, not just those 2,000 years ago, but here and now too. The coming of the Spirit signalled that the gospel was for all, irrespective of age, culture, or ethnicity. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. In our busy lives, it is easy to live without an awareness of the Spirit's power or his presence, or a dependence on his empowering. And to quote A.W. Tozer again, revivals come only to those who want them badly enough. The problem is not to persuade God to fill us, but to want God sufficiently to let him do so. So that leaves us with this question. Do we want God sufficiently to let him fill us and empower us for mission and to set us on fire for Jesus? Let us pray. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on us today. Break us, melt us, mould us, fill us. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on us today. Amen.
Thank you everyone who's contributed so far in our service. Thank you, Sandra. Thank you to everyone else. We're going to sing our final hymn, Lord for the Years. Final prayer for us. May the Spirit of truth lead us into all truth. Give us grace to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, and strengthen us to proclaim the word and works of God. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with us and remain with us this Pentecost Sunday and forevermore. In a moment, I'm going to ask Ruth to open the microphone so that we can, as it were, share the piece together. And then we're going to be going into breakout rooms, if you'd like to stay for that. If you don't want to stay for breakout rooms, please just leave the meeting. Otherwise, if you do, you'll be put with a few people. Just chat with them as you would over coffee in church afterwards. Ask how things are going and that kind of thing. And stay around for as long as you'd like. Or just leave when you'd like to, maybe just politely saying you're going to leave the breakout room now. But let us remember that God has made us one in Christ. He has set his seal upon us, and as a pledge of what is to come, has given us the Spirit to dwell in our hearts. And for that we can say, Alleluia, praise the Lord. May the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
With you.
Wonderful. Thanks, friends. Thanks for a lovely service. Thanks for being together. And do stay around for breakout rooms if you'd like to. And have a great week. And I hope to see some of you at some point walking around.